Hello followers of Neuro Takeaway, welcome back to the channel. This week we are going to dive into deeper waters. We are going to follow the advice of Aristotle, who said that you cannot untie a knot if you don't know how it is made. So for understanding the pathology of our brain vessels, which are different from the rest of the vessels of our body, we have to know how they are made. In doing so, we are going to ask our dear friend Timo Krings for his cooperation. Timo is a professor of neuroradiology at the University of Toronto. He is an expert in the field, and he will explain to us first the process of vasculogenesis and angiogenesis, and next week he will advance on the applications of these concepts to understand the pathology of the brain vessels that we see on our daily practice. So without further ado, let's go to listen to Timo and enjoy.
You asked me to speak about new insights into genetics of vascular diseases, and I put the subtitle into it, Understanding Angiogenesis and Vasculogenesis, because this is in fact what is the underlying mechanism and the underlying features that we'll have to look at in order to understand how vascular diseases are formed and how vascular diseases actually affect the body and how our treatment affects these vascular diseases. We'll start off with just a brief definition of what is vasculogenesis, angiogenesis. We'll then go into growth factors, the angiogenic switch, and we will mainly focus on the applications of angiogenesis and vasculogenesis in vascular diseases and their genetics. What is vasculogenesis? Vasculogenesis means that endothelial tubes form de novo, i.e. in the beginning of vasculogenesis there are no vascular cells at all, there are no vascular tubes at all, and after vasculogenesis the first tubes are formed. This means that vasculogenesis can only happen once in your life, i.e. in utero. On the contrary, angiogenesis means that there's a formation of new blood vessels from already pre-existing ones. And this happens both in utero, but also multiple times during your life, during your postnatal life, depending on your growth, depending on the remodeling of your normal blood vessels. In the beginning of the vasculogenesis, the endothelial cells differentiate and proliferate within an avascular tissue. They coalesce and form a primitive tubular network. Then this primitive tubular network is remodeled, pruned, new vessels will form into where previously no vessels were. Some vessels will no longer be necessary and they will be taken away. And thus your vessel will mature and will grow. Then from pre-existing vessels, through a destabilization process, new vessels will form into avascular tissue, and this is then angiogenic sprouting. To enable all of this, we'll need different growth factors. In fact, the growth factors that are acting on the vascular endotheliums are families of growth factors. The most important one is vascular endothelial growth factor. We have, in addition, the angiopoietins, the afferents, and they all act on the endothelium. The non-endothelial cell growth factor are TGF-beta and platelet-derived growth factor dependent. And all of these growth factors have to work together in a coordinated manner to form stable and mature blood vessels. The VEGF family is the most critical driver of vascular formation. It initiates the formation of primary immature endothelial cells by either vasculogenesis or angiogenic sprouting. VEGF itself is regulated by the oxygen tension in the tissue. If the oxygen tension in the tissue is low, HIF, i.e. hypoxia-inducible factor, will be upregulated. If HIF is upregulated, VEGF will be upregulated. If you only give VEGF without the other growth factors, you will have the formation of only leaky, immature and unstable vessels that are more prone to rupture. If, on the other hand, you have no VEGF or no VEGF receptor, then you will have no vasculature, very few endothelial cells, and mice engineered to have no receptor or no VEGF cannot survive. The best example of how VEGF works if you are looking at retinal vascularization. In retinal vascularization, you have normally an angiogenic sprouting into the initially avascular and hypoxic rodent retina. If you put those rodents under hyperoxia, you will have less HIF, therefore less VEGF, and therefore you have no vessel ingrowth into the retina. If you then put the rodent back into normoxic condition, then the retina gets, because it's now hypovascularized, it gets hypoxic, VEGF will increase, and you will have angiogenesis with leaky vessels. And actually this happens not only in rodents, but it can also happen in newborn babies. This is when you put the newborn baby into an incubator where there's like an increased hyperbaric oxic level, then there are no vessels that are forming into the retina. The retina is getting under-vascularized, and then if the premature baby is then put back into normoxic conditions, there will be an under-vascularization of the retina. Therefore, HIF will increase, VEGF will increase, leaky vessels will form, and this is why premature babies that were in an incubator under hyperoxic conditions can actually get blind because of the bleeding into their retina. In addition to the VEGF that is important for formation of new vessels, we'll need angiopoietins. And angiopoietins are important for maturing the blood vessel. Mice that lack angiopoietin, i.e. that only have VEGF, develop a normal primary vasculature, because this is VEGF dependent, but there's failure to associate these primary vessels with their supporting cells, which will lead to missing remodeling of the primary vasculature. On the other hand, if you have an overexpression of angiopoietin, then you will have a hypervascularization with increase in vessel size, but not in vessel number, and those vessels are also resistant to leakage. There are two different types of angiopoietins. Angiopoietin 1 is the stabilizer, angiopoietin 2 is the destabilizer. And why do we need a destabilizer? Since we are constantly growing, new vessels may need to sprout from pre-existing one, but they can only sprout from those pre-existing ones if the pre-existing vessel gets and reverts to a more plastic state that will then either lead to the regression of vessels in the absence of VEGF or to the formation of new vessels in the presence of VEGF, i.e. angiopoietin 2 is therefore important for pruning and the initiation of angiogenic sprouting. Overall, the roles of the angiopoietins are for blood vessel maturation. They induce the remodeling and stabilization of blood vessels through interactions with the extracellular matrix, and they maintain stability of the mature vasculature. The third family of growth factors that act onto the endotheliums are the efferents. And while angiopoietins were maturing the blood vessel, VEGF were making the blood vessels, the efferents are telling the blood vessel about its identity, i.e. whether it will become an artery or a vein. So the efferent B2, for example, is an arterial marker, versus the efferent B4 is a venous marker. Interestingly enough, the efferents are also important for the regulation of the interaction between the smooth muscle cells and the endothelial cells. And its receptor participates also in the guidance of axons and the CNS development. And this is of importance when we are looking at, for example, the fact that certain vascular malformations can be associated with brain developmental malformations. We all know that DVAs can be associated with focal cortical dysplasias. AVMs can be associated with polymicrogyria. And this interaction is guided through efferents, indicating that the blood vessel development is not only dependent on, or is not only interacting like with the blood vessel itself, but is actually also interacting with the adjacent brain. So this slide here summarizes and exemplifies what we have learned so far about growth factors. There are multiple different growth factors on the VEGF side, on the angiopoietin side, and on the efferents, and they are responsible for the vasculogenesis, the secondarily angiogenesis, and as the efferents were discussed previously, for the interaction with the remainder of the brain and for making the identity of a blood vessel. Now that we've discussed the growth factors and their roles, we will dive deeper into the vasculogenesis. Vasculogenesis happens only once in life. It is when endothelial cells differentiate and proliferate within a primarily avascular tissue. They coalesce and form a tubular network, i.e. the primary vasculature. This primary vasculature happens to appear within the mesoderm, i.e. in between the ectoderm and the endoderm. And what is happening here is that from the mesoderm, certain cells, the vasculogenic cells, segregate, migrate towards the endoderm, form the primary vascular cords, that then differentiate into endothelial cells and that then coalesce to form the primary vascular network. So this primary vascular network is promoted by the endoderm, it is inhibited by the ectoderm, and it is promoted by VEGF that in itself is regulated by HIF, i.e. hypoxia-inducible factor, that will tell the blood vessels where to form, where to go, because it is induced through hypoxemia. The arteries are formed within the endoderm, and it is interesting that those growth factors that are important for this are not only VEGF but also NOTCH3, and we all know that NOTCH3 mutations are important, for example, for CADASIL, because this is where the mutation occurs in CADASIL, and this leads, if you don't have this receptor, if you don't have the NOTCH3 receptor, then there is a problem of an overaccumulation of debris within the blood vessels and thus a microangiopathy that will lead to CADASIL, that will lead to early strokes. Where do arteries and veins come from? In the body, both the endothelial cells, the pericytes, the smooth muscle, and the connective cells all are derived from the mesoderm. However, in the head and neck region, the pericytes, smooth muscle, and connective cells are derived from the neural crest. And this indicates that the blood vessels of our head, neck, and brain area are completely different blood vessels from the blood vessels in our arm, in the heart, or in the rest of our body. For the head and neck and brain vessels, we need to have both the mesoderm and the neural crest ectoderm, neuroectoderm, to actually come together to form a vessel, which again tells us that there's a direct interaction between the neuroectoderm, between the central nervous system and the blood vessels, which is not the case in the rest of the body. It also tells us that blood vessels will presumably act differently when they are treated in the heart as compared to the brain, because the blood vessels are completely differently made up as compared in the brain to the heart. Now let's talk a little bit about angiogenesis. While vasculogenesis is the formation of the primary vasculature, angiogenesis means that you have a remodeling of the primitive network by vessel enlargement, where we need them, and vessel pruning, where we don't need them any longer. And this angiogenic remodeling is governed by, again, VEGF, angiopoietin 1 and 2. The best example for the pruning is actually what is happening with the aortic arches during embryogenesis. During embryogenesis, we have all of these arteries of the pharyngeal branches that will later on form the internal carotid artery, the external carotid artery, the vertebral arteries, etc. But in order for them to form, they need to be pruned. Some vessels are actually getting larger, some vessels don't need to be there any longer. And this is happening during angiogenesis. The endothelial cells blood vessels are important for the development. In fact, they are not just inert cells lining the tubes, but they are actively involved in the differentiation and in the formation of head and neck structures. They secrete certain paracrine substances, the so-called endothelines, and these endothelines are important to make your head and neck morphology. In fact, if you don't have endothelians, you do have craniofacial malformations. So the blood vessels and the face and the neck and the brain are actually interplaying and interacting with each other and are important for the facial development. And this will explain, for example, diseases such as faces, where we have not only malformation of the arteries, but where we also have malformation of the craniocervical junction. As I told you, there's an important interplay between the mesoderm and the neural crest in the formation of the blood vessels. In fact, the neural crest cells and the mesodermal cells have to find each other to form the blood vessels. And these neural crest cells, they are not migrating from the neural crest towards the head and neck region in a random fashion. They are migrating along predetermined pathways. And this will explain to us later why we can have certain neurovascular malformations that are aligned in a somatic fashion, i.e. where we will have arteriovenous malformation not only of the brain but also of the head and neck region. So if we want to summarize the cascade of cephalic vessel formation, in response to low oxygen, HIF-1 alpha is secreted. This will lead to an increase of VEGF. This will lead to the foundation of the aortic arch cage around the pharyngeal endoderm. This will then form the head and neck structures. And this will then be remodeled due to the angiogenesis. While this was the embryonic angiogenesis, there's also a postnatal angiogenesis. The postnatal angiogenesis occurs in any given moment while we are growing, but even once we are completely grown, our blood vessels do not stay the same. In fact, it is believed that they are remodeled every 7 years. And this remodeling has to go through a destabilization process. Again, here our angiopoietin 2 necessary. And this stable, mature vessel will therefore get into an unstable vessel due to this angiopoietin 2. If there's no VEGF present, the blood vessel will regress. If there is VEGF presence, i.e. if there's evidence for hypoxemia, then you will get angiogenic sprouting. So therefore, in your postnatal angiogenesis, you will have to have a dissolution of the outer mural elements. Your vessel has to get more plastic. There's an activation of the endothelial cells, sprouting. Then we have to again remature them, i.e. a recoverage of parasites, and the vessel is reconstituted. This postnatal angiogenesis is again governed by the same growth factors that we saw in antenatal angiogenesis. Normally, endothelial cells rarely divide. In fact, it is believed that they only divide once in 3 to 14, presumably 7 years, which means that your blood vessels are now completely different blood vessels than the ones that you had 7 years ago or that you will have in 7 years. Which will also tell us something about how AVMs will form and what the life cycle of an AVM is, and we will get later towards this. Endothelial cells under hypoxemic conditions can be induced to replicate very fast, i.e. once in every 5 days. And this will explain us why certain tumors with large angiogenic potential can form blood vessels and can grow very fast. In fact, here we have such an example. A tumor grows, and once the tumor grows, it will get like hungry for oxygen, there will be hypoxemia, so VEGF will increase and then blood vessels will sprout into this tumor to help it further grow. And this again now helps us to understand how, for example, Avastin works. Avastin is an inhibitor of VEGF. If you inhibit VEGF, then no blood vessels will be able to grow into a tumor. And if no blood vessels grow into the tumor, then this means that most of the tumor will die. This is why Avastin is a very potent drug that you give in patients with glioblastoma multiforme. However, it also explains to you now the process of pseudo-regression. In pseudo-regression, you have still tumor growth, but this tumor, the GBM, is no longer enhancing. Remember what VEGF does? VEGF produces leaky vessels, i.e. vessels that form or where you have contrast enhancement. If you inhibit VEGF, you will have less leaky vessels, i.e. your blood vessel, your tumor, does no longer enhance, but it may still grow if it finds its oxygen from other regions. We discussed about growth factors, vasculogenesis, angiogenesis. Now we'll have to discuss about the so-called angiogenic switch. The angiogenic switch means the differentiation from the activation phase, where your basement membrane is degraded, where new endothelial cells sprout towards the avascular tissue, to the resolution phase, where there's a stop of endothelial cell proliferation and where the basement membrane is reconstructed. This switch from the activation to the resolution phase is governed by two genes, by the endoglin gene and by the ALK1 gene. If you have no endoglin or no ALK1, there's an imbalance of activation versus resolution, and this will lead to structural abnormalities of vessels, i.e. it will lead to abnormal shunts. And the disease that is present when you have no endoglin and ALK1 is actually morbus Rendo-Weber-Osler or hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia, HHT, where you have too many abnormal shunts. And we will discuss upon this later.
Well, thank you very much, Timo, for this excellent introduction to this hard topic. Next week, we will have the second part about the applications of this knowledge. And I have two announcements. One has to do with the upcoming realization of the third Canadian Neurological Congress, which will be held between the 13th and 15th of November. It will be virtual and free, so you can register on the link which is below. It will be very interesting. It will have many outstanding professors from all around the world, as Professor Andrea Rossi from Italy. The main topics will be pediatrics, tumors, and neurometabolic diseases of the adults. The second announcement has to do with our channel, Neuro Takeaway. We are very happy with your support. We have a lot of subscribers, but for those of you that haven't subscribed yet, please do so, because it's always a very important stimulus for us to keep on with this undertaking. So see you next week. Bye bye.